It's the appointed time and we have a quorum. Let's ask the government officials to enter the room.
Hi, 早晨。
Good morning. The list of follow-up actions arising from the meeting on the 22nd of April has been set out on the agenda and sent to members. I will ask the administration to explain their reply. If there are no questions, we will proceed to clause-by-clause scrutiny. Mr. Mack or Ms. Chang? Ms. Chang, please. Thank you, Chairman. The members asked three questions in the last meeting. First one, in relation to clause 52 of the bill, under cap 374, the new section proposed, 63(2), that empowers a police officer to require any person to provide certain information in relation to an alleged offense or an accident. Members were of the view that any person referred to it in this context is wider in the scope than the description in the existing section 63(1), and it would like to see if there is any room for narrowing the scope of the definition. But the proposed amendment is only to add the serving of a section 63 demand notice by electronic means and to amend the drafting of some of the provisions. The scope of the definition has not been amended. As for the detailed explanation, please refer to our reply. We want to stress that when the police officers investigate traffic accidents or offenses, they may from time to time require vehicle owners and drivers to provide information to cooperate with investigation. It is common in the transport sector that some vehicle owners may not directly manage all the vehicles registered in their names and may appoint an agent, for example, a car dealership, to manage the vehicles on their behalf. When these vehicles managed by a car dealership are involved in traffic accidents or offenses, these agents may provide information of the drivers to the police officers for follow action. And Section 63 demand may be issued to the agents. If we narrow down the scope of the definition, it will affect the police officers' enforcement action. Under the principles of administrative law, the police officers should ensure that the exercise of relevant powers is reasonable, and they will make sure that the person involved has a role to play in the accident before a Section 63 notice will be issued. The police force will also remind frontline officers of the principle of administrative law again to ensure that the relevant powers are exercised reasonably. That also, we will be providing a defense under cap 374. If a person did not know and could not with reasonable diligence have ascertained the personal particulars of the driver involved, they can propose a defense in the court of law. So we think that the bill has struck a balance between enforcement efficiency and protection of public interest. It may not be appropriate to narrow the scope of application. Follow-up action B. It's about personal particulars and the definition of it, which includes residential address. The members ask if we should specify the address as a residential address. The purpose of asking the relevant person to provide address is to conduct further investigation. Taking the issuance of notice to vehicle owners an example, the address of the driver concerned provided by the vehicle owners is in general a correspondent address known to him for contacting the driver. The vehicle owner may not actually know or be able to verify whether the address is the driver's residential address. the police officer will verify and contact the driver after obtaining the information. If the police officer is unable to contact the driver, they will contact the vehicle owner again. At present, it's been operating very smoothly for a police officer to obtain an address to carry out their duties. Thank you. I think the explanation is very clear. If there's no further questions, let's move on to the clause by clause. We're at 129 last time. Ms. Chang, please. We were at section 63 in the last meeting. We can start from section 63A this time. 63A is 128 in the English marked up copy. That is C4053 of the bill. Yes, the newly proposed section 63A is to amend 63(2), which specifies that the notice should be served personally or by post. If the person is the registered owner of the vehicle, the post should be, or the mail should be sent to the registered address. If the demand is made on the driver concerned or any other person, the driver's or the person's last known postal address should be where the mail should be sent to. The provisions set out that the notice can be sent by electronic means through e-contact means. And the person should be able to check the notice in the information system designated by the Commissioner of Police. And the electronic message in the specified form should be sent to the relevant person involved. The following five information should be included, including the way in which the corresponding demand notice may be inspected, the period for the provision of the information, the consequence for failing to provide information, method of inquiry, and the date of the message. Thank you, Mr. Tony Chang. I would like to ask about 63(a)(1)(b). Under item 2, it is set post to or the person's last known postal address. There are items 1 and 2 under post 2. And it is set under item 2, the person's last known postal address. Do we know what the last known postal address of the person is? What does last known mean? Ms. Chang? Thank you. The police officers would issue the demand notice upon receipt of the address to verify if the person can actually receive the notice. Well, in terms of verification by posting the mail or notice, are you sending the notice to multiple addresses or are you sending the notice to just one address? The government may maintain records of the people's address. How do you determine what the last known postal address of the person is? Or are you sending multiple notices to multiple addresses? Thank you for the question. According to the information provided by the vehicle owner, that would be the address to which we sent the notice to. If the registered address of the driver is different from the record, then we will refer to the information provided by the vehicle owner. The last known postal address is the one provided by the vehicle owner. So we take the address provided by the vehicle owner as the correct one, as the last known postal address, and that's where you will send the notice to. Is that right? Yes. So the address of the driver in your record will not be considered the last known postal address. Is that right? For the address registered with the transport department, that may not be the latest address of the driver. We will consider the address provided by the vehicle owner the last known postal address, because the driver may not live at the address recorded in the transport department. We consider the address provided by the vehicle owner the last known postal address. Mr. Lai Tong Kwok, is the use of the term last effective? All we want to know is the address of the person to whom the notice should be served on. You use the words known, well, you should have just used the word known address instead of last known address. A person may have 4 to 5 addresses, and they may move their residences from time to time. I think you should call the job done as soon as you have sent the notice to the person. You don't have to be as restrictive as to put the word last here. You may not be able to discharge your responsibility if you restrict the postal address to the last known postal address. Mr. Lai, please. From the DOJ. Thank you. Last known postal address means the latest address. Objectively speaking, a person may give different addresses to different parties. As explained by the police force just now, when they investigate, they ask the relevant persons their latest postal address. And that address should be the last known postal address. Thank you, Chairman. It would be clear if you refer to the English version. Mr. Chen Xiuhong. For this last known postal address, 63A supplementary provisions to section 63, bracket 1, bracket A, bracket B, Roman number 1 and 2, refer to requirements under section 63. Post 2, the driver's or person's last known postal address. It would be clear if we refer to section 63. If the police officers require the person to provide information, the details include postal address. So do we have to specify last known postal address here? You should just refer to section 63 bracket 2. That is the information that the police demand a person to provide. You should just refer the readers to section 63 bracket 2. It could be that the driver or person involved does not provide relevant information, then they would be in violation of the law. If you still like to identify the driver, you may send the notice to the registered address of the driver. That is why you include these words, last known postal address, in section 63 bracket A. What is the reason for specifying it here?
Well, I believe they have drafted it in this way because they want to have someone provide their last known postal address and they can have the notice sent to that address. Chair, I think there is a logical problem here. In reality, the driver concerned may have two or three addresses. What would be the most recent one? And I think you should just refer to section 63 brackets 2. And if people have provided an address with their personal particulars, they should just make use of it, and that should be the most recent address. Well, any supplementary information to be provided by the department, I consider your explanation to be quite clear, to be honest. Anything to add from the police force in response to Mr. Chen Su-hong's questions? Chair, I have only concerns about the practice of the police force. When you have contact with the driver, what information would you obtain from them? Also, when you obtain information from the vehicle owner, you should have an address of the driver. And if an address is not provided, you would look to the records for the address, so it would be either way, correct? Mr. Chen, from the police force. Thank you. In general, when we issue a demand notice, the vehicle owner has the responsibility to identify the driver. Of course, the owner may not know where the driver lives, and they would have the responsibility to contact the driver to find out about that and put such information in the notice. And when a notice is sent to the address and there is no reply, we will then look to our records to see if the driver concerned has any other registered addresses with us. If there are, we will try to contact the driver again. Otherwise, we would contact the owner again to ask them to reach out to the driver to provide us with a new address. We will also remind the owner and the driver that they may have breached the laws of the transport department in the sense that the registered information is different from that in reality. Well, Mr. Frank Yik, thank you. My understand that if there is an accident and a driver is there and personal particulars can be obtained from the driver themselves. But when it is not the case, one would have to go to the owner, and the owner should provide information on the address of the driver. And what the police said, when they said the owner would have the responsibility to provide information to the driver, in reality, it may be difficult because in some cases, the driver's identity may be unknown. I think it is a loophole that may be exploited, and I think this loophole should be plugged. So you're talking about how vehicle owners would have the responsibility to provide information on the last known address of the person. So there is a need for last known postal address to be stated here. All right, thank you. Please proceed. We have section 63B to be added, obligation to provide information in respect of alleged offenses or accidents. It is said that the person on whom a demand notice is served, the person must provide to the police officer the information specified within 21 days after the date of the demand notice or the date of the corresponding electronic message, if any, whichever is the later. If it is conveyed electronically, as I said earlier, it would also have to be within 21 days after the date of the corresponding electronic message. The information must be provided in the form specified in the notice. And if a person contravenes the relevant sections, they are liable on conviction to a fine at level 3 and to imprisonment for 6 months. In subsection 7, there is a defense available. If the person can show that the person did not know and could not with reasonable diligence have ascertained the personal particulars of the driver concerned, and the demand notice has not come to the personal notice of that person without any neglect by that person, they would be acquitted. Mr. Tony Zhe, I want to ask about subsection 7A for the defense. If the person can show that they did not know, can you give us some examples where defendants have proved that they did not know and were acquitted? How could they prove that? Mr. Chen Xiuming. Thank you, member, for the questions. In general, it would be the case that when a vehicle is stolen, or if a vehicle is never registered, and when there are contraventions, it is found that the vehicle owner is that person, then the vehicle owner may not be aware of that. Chair, I have a question. So if a vehicle is stolen, so does one have to prove that they know the vehicle is stolen and that wouldn't be it? I'm not sure if it is the case. I'm just seeking a clarification here. Because it would be hard for one to prove someone who does not know something. So if a vehicle is stolen and there are contraventions made with that vehicle, the owner may not be aware of that. Mr. Chen Xiuming. Well, indeed, it may be the case that the owner may not be aware of such, but we will let our criminal investigation colleagues investigate the claims to see if they are indeed true, and they will make reference to the relevant records, investigation records, to see if the claims are real. Chair, the penalty would be a fine at level 3 and imprisonment for 6 months. If it is the case that for one who has contravened the relevant subsections and prosecution is initiated, you would have already considered such scenarios. You would not wait until the court proceedings have begun to see whether a person would have a defense for breaching the relevant subsections. Mr. Chen Xiuming. Well, as I said earlier, if a vehicle is stolen, we'll let our criminal investigation colleagues to see if the vehicle has indeed been reported stolen. And if it is the case, we would consider the claims to be substantiated in a sense, and we would consider that when making the prosecution charges. And if we find out the claims are not true, we will have the criminal investigation colleagues continue to follow up on that, and the traffic contravention in particular will be followed up on by the traffic colleagues, and the investigations will be conducted in parallel. Chair, simply put, when the police consider whether to press charges, they would consider various factors, and I assume they would consider whether any defense is available for the defendant or the person concerned. And if a defense is available, for example, if a person can say why they have inadvertently breached the subsections, they will consider such scenarios when initiating prosecution, correct? Well, thank you. When we initiate prosecutions, criminal or traffic prosecutions, we would consider all information or justifications provided by the driver and the owner or the people concerned. Once we have found out more about such cases, once we have adequate evidence, we will initiate prosecutions. So we will consider comprehensively the factors concerned before we initiate prosecutions. I will now assign a time limit, Mr. Loi Tung Kwok. Thank you. When you talk about 363B2A, is this a strict liability offense? That is, the prosecution would not have to prove mens rea. Is that correct? Thank you, Chair. I'll have this question answered first. Thank you. Well, who is going to answer this question? Mr. Lai from the DOJ. Thank you, Chair. I want to clarify, is it the case that you are asking about 63B2A? Yes, 63B2A, the one relating to the driver concerned. Well, it is the case if the person is requested to provide information orally. And in A, if the person is the driver concerned, they must immediately provide to the police officer their personal particulars. Let me put it this way, as Mr. Loi Tung Kwok said, if the person refuses to provide such information, it would be a contravention. If the person has special reasons, then we would have to consider them. If there are no special reasons, then that would immediately be a contravention. Chair, now I have a follow-up question. So if one is drink driving and they're in the seat, they can't even drive, and they've parked the vehicle on one side, and when they're asked what your name is, they did not respond. If they're influenced by alcohol, can you charge them with this provision? I think that with subsection 7, defense may be available to the person. So is it the case that you can't charge the person with the offense in 2A? What do you mean by a defense is available under subsection 7? Well, it is because in subsection 7, it is said that the person did not know and could not with reasonable diligence have ascertained the personal particulars of the driver concerned. So if one has drunk alcohol, they may not be able to provide such information with reasonable diligence.
Mr. Chan Xiuming, thank you, Chairman, and thank you for the question. In real life settings, the person has the responsibility to provide all relevant personal particulars when we ask them orally at the scene. But if the driver is drunk, then we will send them to the hospital and we will try to see if the driver has their Hong Kong ID card on them, or we will record what the driver told us at the scene. When the driver became sober, we will ask them their personal particulars once again. That information may or may not be accurate. Based on the actual circumstances, we will see if we will charge that person with the relevant offenses. We have to take into account the actual circumstances, and we will also consult the doctor how drunk the person is. Chairman, I would like to follow up on my question. 63B(2A), there's this word immediately there. When the driver is drunk, they cannot immediately provide the personal particulars to the police. If you don't have to prove mens rea, it means that the person has violated the law. Can you charge them with another offense? That's my question. If the person is drunk and cannot immediately provide the police with personal particulars, will you charge them? A brief answer, please. Thank you. If that's the case, we believe that we won't charge them with the offense, but that depends on the actual situation. We would ask the person that question, but if that person is so drunk as to not able to answer our questions, I don't think that there's a point in continuing with the question. And if the doctor says that the person involved is suitable to go through an interview, we will put those questions to them once again. We decide if we will charge the person based on actual circumstances. Thank you. Mr. Frankie Yik, thank you. The vehicle owner has the responsibility to provide the person particulars of the driver. The defense is if the vehicle owners has reported their vehicle being stolen. I think that there is another case where the vehicle owners have hung a fake license plate. And I think that the CCTV would show that the vehicles with the registered registration mark would not have left the car park, and I think that would constitute another defense. First, it could be that the person have his vehicle owner vehicle stolen, and if a false registration mark or license plate has been put on the vehicle, then that could be another defense. And if the person used a false identity to register the vehicle owner vehicle, then we may not be able to identify the driver. If there is no other question, let's proceed. 63C, information provided in form of electronic record. 63C bracket 1, if the person on whom a demand notice is served wishes to provide any information specified in the form of an electronic record, the person must sign the electronic record and send the information to the information system designated by the Commissioner of Police. The electronic record is taken to have received by the police officer specified in the demand notice if the electronic record is sent in accordance with subsection bracket 1, bracket B, and if accepted. Bracket 3, the requirement for a signature on the electronic record is met by if the specified person is a natural person, is digital signature of specified person or password of that person assigned or approved. If the specified person is a corporation, a digital signature of a person who is authorized by the specified person to send the electronic records for the specified person and a password of the specified person assigned or approved by the Commissioner of Police. Mr. Chan Xiuhong, this is quite an interesting new subsection. We will be making use of digital signature and electronic record. I think that we have to make the relevant amendments. But it seems that we rely on iamSmart for the digital signature. We don't have the relevant arrangements for corporation. 63C says that if the vehicle is owned by a corporation, the corporation can authorize a person to sign the record on behalf of the corporation. By corporation, you mean the corporation owning the vehicle, is that right? Yes. So after the bill is passed, this arrangement will be implemented. When will we set up digital signature for corporations? Some policy matters have just been approved, and $300 million have been approved for the implementation of digital signature for corporation and corporate ID. So will you be creating a platform to ask the corporation to provide certain particulars, and then I am smart will be connected, and the person can sign the electronic record off with a digital signature. Will the information of the specified person included in the vehicle registration? If the corporation have to provide information after the accident has happened, do we ask the vehicle owners to authorize someone to sign the electronic record? Thank you. The police force will be arranging a tour for the LegCo members to take a look at their system. The tour will happen in June, approximately. Mr. Chan, please. Thank you. I can tell members about our preliminary design of a system as to how we can deal with a corporation. For personal vehicle owners and drivers, we will send them an SMS, and they will, through iamSmart, submit the personal particulars to us. As for corporation, after securing the contact of the corporation, we will send them a one-time password. And the corporation can send the one-time password to the agent, and then the agent can send us the relevant information. The agents have to give us the one-time password, and they have to enter it into the system before they can enter the information of the drivers on the platform. As for the corporation, the one-time password is a special arrangement to verify the person that is representing the corporation, or verify the identity of the person representing the corporation. It would be better if we can take a look at the systems before we scrutinize the bill. We don't really have a full picture of the arrangement. As a regular member of the public, as a vehicle owner, drivers, we don't really know what the arrangement is, hence the confusion. The system is not ready yet. We have to wait until June. The secretary is working out the schedule with the police. On the 24th of June, we'll be having that visit. If we can take a look at the system earlier, that would facilitate our scrutiny. But the truth is, the system is not ready, and we can only take the tour on the 24th of June. Mr. Chan Xiuhong, if we have a corporation version of the iamSmart, that would facilitate the signing of an electronic record. If we have that version, can the vehicle owner make use of the digital signature and submit relevant information on the iamSmart platform directly? For this corporation version of the iamSmart, we don't really have much information on that yet as to when, if it's ready or not. We'll see if the systems is complementary with our arrangement. Please be very brief, Mr. Chen. It seems that the bill has not incorporated the upcoming corporation version of the iamSmart. Because we have approved $300 million for the corporation version of the iamSmart, I think that we should include that here. When that's ready, corporation can make use of digital signature and certificate to submit information like what a natural person would do. Will you be able to make sure that there is interfacing when the corporation version of the iamSmart is ready? Because if there is not such a corporation of the IM Smart included in the bill, then the corporation will have to authorize a person to sign the electronic record or submit information. Mr. Lai Tong Kwok, under subclause 3B, corporation is used, and in English is Fatun is used. The Chinese translation of corporation is sometimes Kei Yip, sometimes Gongxi Company. The Chinese translation of corporation is Fatun. Is that defined under the bill? Or can we quote from other ordinances as for the Chinese translation of the corporation? By corporation, do you mean legal person? Under a statute law, is there a definition of the word corporation or legal person? A company, a limited company, an incorporated owners, are they included or covered by the word corporation? I don't think that's clear enough. Because vehicle owners may not be a natural person. It could be a limited companies or other forms of companies. Thank you. Mr. Lai? Thank you, Chairman. When we specify a natural person in the ordinance, it means a regular person. Under cap 1 of the laws of Hong Kong, a person covers legal person and a natural person. That is why we have to make such a distinction. That is why we specify a natural person in the bill, and we also specify corporation to mean a group in the bill to make sure that there will not be any confusion. So by corporation, you mean company, incorporated owners, groups, organizations. Is that right? Yes. Mr. Lai, is there a definition for the word corporation in the laws of Hong Kong? Just now, DOJ representative said that they make use of the definition of a person under cap 1. But under 3A, you use natural person. That is why that means that you are not using the definition of person under cap 1. For the second part, you use the word corporation. If there is a definition of corporation under the bill, that would be fine. And if you say that the natural persons means the person as defined under cap 1, but if there is not a definition, there could be dispute. That's my question. The government saying that is clear under the bill, but when people invoke the law, there could be disputes. If there is anything that is unclear under the bill, perhaps we should clarify it so that we don't have to dwell on it in the court of law. We are still at the stage of scrutiny. If there is room for us to make the law clearer, that would facilitate enforcement. Thank you.
Mr. Lai from DOJ. Well, legally, if a term has been defined in legislation, we would use that. But for many words, there is no need to define them because the dictionary definitions would already be quite clear. For example, for corporation, I did a quick search in the Oxford Dictionary. Corporation would mean an organization or a group of organizations that is recognized by law as a single unit. And this is already quite clear. include an organization or a group of organizations. And these would not be natural persons. I believe the interpretation is quite clear. Thank you, Chair. Chair, I think we have to look at the Chinese version because they do not say in particular it would be a group of organizations or in the sense that it would only have a meaning of a single corporation. So I think that there may be confusion. Of course, dictionaries have their own definitions, and if there are any disputes, the court would have to rule on the policy intent to see if the definition is valid. And if someone argues that there is a difference between the Chinese and English versions, there may be confusion, which is why I'm pointing out this problem here. I'll perhaps ask the legal advisor to speak on the issue. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Lai, for the questions. I have reviewed again the bill. The word corporation is not defined in the bill. The representative of the administration said the dictionary definition would include several categories, and I have gone online just now. I believe the dictionary definition is clear, and if the definition is clear, there is no need for it to be defined in the bill. Thank you, Chair. I think Mr. Lai is only asking things to be defined clearly. As for what Mr. Chen said about the business version of I Am Smart, whether it can be accommodated with this bill, any response from the administration, Ms. Ching? Well, we believe with the category being a corporation here, the one who is making the operations can be the specified person. If there is a need to change the provisions in future, we'll definitely review that. Thank you. Please proceed. Thank you, Chair. Section 63D requirements specified for digital signature under Section 63C bracket 6. And the requirements specified are that the digital signature is supported by a recognized certificate. The digital signature is generated within the validity and is used in accordance with the terms. All right, please proceed. Thank you. Section 63E relates to certificates of service and the certificate of service specifications are set out in Section 63E. Thank you. Please proceed. Section 63F. Commissioner of Police may specify forms of certain documents, that is, a demand notice, an electronic message, and a certificate of service, and these notices are not subsidiary legislation. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Thank you, Chair. Section 63G, designation of information system by Commissioner of Police. The Commissioner of Police may, by notice published in the Gazette, designate an information system, and a notice published in the Gazette under this subsection is not subsidiary legislation. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Thank you. Clause 54. Page 142 of the Martial Copy in the Chinese version. It amends Section 64. It will be renumbered as Section 64.1. And we have also amended certain wording. We also suggest adding 64.2.2.6 after Section 64.1. We are providing these provisions to make sure such electronic records are accepted in court as evidence. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Clause 55. It adds Section 64A after 64, Section 64. Section 64A, presumption of identity of signatory of electronic record signed and sent. We provide this in the absence of the evidence to the contrary. The person named in an electronic record as the person who signed the record is to be regarded as the person who signed the record. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Clauses 56 and 57, they amend sections 68 and 69. These are just technical amendments, amending certain wording in the sections. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Clause 58, it amends section 114. We have amended the reference for Ordinance 1975. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Clauses 59 to 61, they amend schedules 8, 10, and 12. Can you talk about the page numbers of the marked up copy? It would be 149 to 156 of the marked up copy in the Chinese version. And in the blue bill, it would be the English version would be C4079. These are just minor and technical amendments. Thank you. Please proceed. We have now reached part 7, amendments to road traffic driving licenses regulations. Chapter 374B. Now we are on the Blue Bill C4083 and page 157 of the marked up copy in the Chinese version. With clause 62, we amend regulation 18 and we have included the terms e-contact means. And like other personal particulars, if there is any change, such change would have to be notified, and the Commissioner for Transport would have to be notified of such amendment. Any questions? Well, I want to ask the Transport Department. Right now, you're talking about such changes would have to be submitted to the Transport Department within 72 hours. Do you have a system for such submissions, or would you ask them to queue in line to make such changes? Well, thank you. Right now on the government's one-stop portal, there is a gateway for citizens to make amendments on their personal particulars. They can also complete forms and submit such to licensing offices, or they can post such to the Transport Department. All right, thank you. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Thank you, Chair. Clause 63 amends Regulation 44B. We have again added the term e-contact means. In both the heading and the text. And we have given power of the Commissioner to require proof of e-contact means. And a one-time password will be issued, and the applicant would have to provide the one-time password in order to verify the e-contact means. Thank you. Any questions? If not, please proceed. We have now got to part 8, amendments to road traffic registration and licensing of vehicles regulations, chapter 374E. It would be page 159 of the marked up copy in the Chinese version and C4089 of the blue bill in the English version. And that would be clause 64, it amends regulation 2. We have repealed the existing definition of e-contact means, because this has been defined previously in the regulations. All right, any questions? If not, please proceed. Thank you. Clause 65 amends Schedule 2. We have proposed to add the term miscellaneous fees and have added numbering for the different categories. It is only an amendment to improve the readability of the provision. Thank you. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Thank you. We have now got to Part 9, related amendments. These are just consequential and technical amendments. Division 1, amendments to Road Traffic Driving Offense Points Ordinance, Chapter 375, clauses 66 and 67. And that would be page 161 of the marked up copy in the Chinese version. They amend sections 2 and 4A. In section 2 in particular, because we have repealed paragraph A, and we have added in through the bill in the relevant ordinance some provisions relating to fixed penalty and the relevant notices. We have made a consequential amendment in this section. All right, thank you. Any questions? If not, please proceed. Thank you. Division 2, amendments to Airport Authority Bylaw 483A. For clause 68, it amends Schedule 2. It has added after 63 in Section 5, Part 1, Schedule 2, 63B, 63E, 63F. We have also amended some references in Section 5A. These are just technical amendments. All right, any questions? Thank you. We have scrutinized all provisions in the bill. Thank you. Anything to add from the legal advisor in the English version? Thank you, Chair. We believe there are no issues with both the Chinese and the English text of the bill. Thank you. We have scrutinized the bill in full. I understand that the administration would propose some committee stage amendments. All right, please refer to the draft committee stage amendments in CB brackets 4485/2024 brackets 01. All right, any questions from members? Or perhaps the administration can first brief members on the paper. We propose to make two amendments. They are technical amendments. We suggest in 3AA, we would repeal the existing section 3 brackets 2. We have also 14.1, 16.4B, and 17.1B. They all refer to the existing section 3 brackets 2, and they will be substituted with section 3AA. These references were not made in the bill, which is why we are proposing committee stage amendments to amend the references. Thank you. All right, any questions from members? These are just technical amendments.
Please proceed. The second amendment is to facilitate drivers. We propose to add under 374B a new provisions for the vehicle license owners to provide e-contact means when they are not renewing their vehicle license or applying for a new vehicle license, so that the police can make use of the e-contact means to send fixed penalty notices. As this new provisions is to allow the members of the public to provide e-contact means to the transport department on their own volition, so no penalty will be involved. This is in response to the members' suggestion, and the government has proposed amendments in light of that. Any questions? No. Legal advisor, please. Thank you, Chairman. In the English version of the proposed amendments, the government may have to further amend page 2 and page 3. On page 2, 63A in road traffic driving license, after that, there should be an English word S. Amendments to regulation, and there's an extra word S here. For page 3, for the proposed 69(3), in the title, electronic traffic enforcement miscellaneous amendments ordinance, there's an S missing. Do you agree, Mr. Lai, Ms. Chang? So please make further amendments. Regarding the legal advisor's comment and the proposed amendments of the government, do members have any other questions? If there's not, the government proposes to resume second reading debate in the council meeting on the 19th of June, 2024. They will submit a report to the House Committee on the 31st of May. Any questions? No. As mentioned, the BC members would like to know more about the procedures of the traffic e-enforcement arrangement. So we hope that in the morning of 24th of June, we can go to the briefing sessions organized by the police force to know more about the enforcement details. So I hope that the members would set aside time for that. The secretariat will invite members to attend the session in due course. Any other questions? If not, thank you very much.
辛苦了秘書處，法律顧問。On time.